variety of constituencies, right? Everything from performers to designers to playwrights, etc. And what we're trying to do, of course, is promote the rich, as it says there, creative world-class contributions by Hispanics, Latinos in the city of Dallas, North Texas. So we're really trying to make it, quote unquote, this particular area, or the focus on this area. And then we just have a, we kind of have a living mission. We're a new group, right? So we're starting in December. So right now we're trying to put together a particular initiative, and what we're trying to work with is with the city council. But the idea that we thought we might need a mission. So we just for right now we have what I call a tentative mission. It's one that we can live with for right now. And the idea, the focus is the notion of dissemination of new works and established works by Latino theater artists, right? So the notion is, and you can read that, is to really enhance visibility, but also to garner a sense of recognition for the work that we do, right? So, and of course, those two go hand in hand, right? So we're trying to build a sense of presence in this particular area, because we're here and we're not going away, right? So, and then hand in hand with that, of course, came up with a vision statement, is all quote-unquote good organizations try to do in terms of put out a particular vision with how they, in a sense, see the future, in a sense, right? So the mission sort of gets into how we're living the present, how we're trying to engage with the present, and then our vision sort of takes us to the future, right? Or at least some kind of aspirational future, right? And so we're trying to procure the structural support within the city of Dallas and surrounding cities to fulfill this particular mission. And so what we're trying to do, as a lot of this group, I'm sure your groups do the same thing, we're really trying to key into or work into finding adequate resources, which means funding resources, right? And at the same time, trying to find a workspace that we, an enduring workspace that we can live in and breathe in and do our work. So those are, as I'm paraphrasing, the vision. So we're trying to engage the mechanisms already in place and perhaps create some new ones along the way in terms of how we might enhance our visibility and our recognition in the city of Dallas. All because we want to serve our particular communities. It's not just about us, it's about how we are serving our particular community. So that's what Dante is. And so I'm sure you have lots of wonderful stories yourself from your particular groups, and we'll get to those in just a second, but we have a little bit of an agenda, so now I'll turn it over to my companion here, Vanessa.
Anyway, thank you for coming. Those of you who are here already for the TCG conference, thank you for coming to this meeting, and for those of you who drove from far and wide, we appreciate you being here. The issue of visibility came up a while ago. It was a TCG study a couple of years ago talking about the relative invisibility of theater in general in Texas, in this area, in Dallas area. And that got me going. I thought, well, if Texas mainstream Dallas theaters were relatively invisible within the broader picture, what about Latinos? Well, we were really, really invisible. So that got me going, and I was able to publish an essay in a volume, Theater in Small Nations in England, very interested in ethnic work, and that got me going to thinking about how many companies there really are here and the work, the Latino work that we do here. So that got me thinking about visibility in terms of, because I'm a scholar, basically, primarily, so visibility happens when somebody writes about your work, when your work is printed, when you are cataloged in a library. It's great to have performances, it's great to have, you need reviews to validate your presence, but you also need to be in academia. Your work needs to be part of the canon, and it's not going to be part of the canon if it's not published. People can't find it. And most of the time I hear this, oh, we love to hire Latinos or have Latino play, but we don't know where to find it. Well, what we want to do is have an anthology of works created in Texas, and we're calling the volume MADE IN TEJAS, of works by people who live and work here, okay? From, and the piece, we are asking that the piece be produced between year 2000 to now, so it's relatively new work. And we're actually going into three different kinds of works that we are interested in producing, I mean in publishing. One is regular plays, one-act plays, full plays, monologues, works by companies and or individual artists. The other is theater for young audiences, which is usually left out or done separately. And we're going to have a third component of devised work, work created collectively. So there's going to be an engagement between the critic, the scholar who writes about the process and the company. In all of the sections for all of the participants, there's going to be a sort of Q&A so that the writer speaks or the artist speaks. We're all asking all the artists to address certain issues. So there'll be the voice of the artist, the work, and then at the end, Tammy's going to be talking about something that she's been working on too that we want to include in the anthology. So please spread the word. We have a deadline of June. We want to work hard on this and fast. We don't want this to be like, you know, 2 years, 3 years, whatever. We want to work it hard and fast. So we have a deadline of, what is it, June something? June 26th, but we're willing to be flexible if you have work that's coming down the pipe. By the way, there are three curators for this. It's Lorenzo, Vanessa, where are you? Vanessa, Mercado Taylor is working with us, and myself, all three of us are curating this. So that's for the plays and the creative work. The other thing that I'm concerned about is locating, and if you can help us, locating scholars that are working in your particular areas, recording the history of the works that you do. Like for instance, Jorge Huerta just came out here a couple of months ago, and he shared with us the activity of the LA Alliance, and they have three scholars working with them. It's Jorge, Tiffany Ann Lopez, and Chantal Rodriguez. They have three scholars working in the LA, Southern California area to go to plays, review plays, see the state of, to report back to the major alliance that, you know, we're all forming nationally. So it would be really cool to have in Tejas, in your particular areas, in Austin, in San Antonio, in the Valley, to locate, to identify scholars who are working on the history of your work. You know, what's going on there? So we can have another volume on the history of Texas theater. There's really a lot of interest in that. Publishers, there's no history of Texas theater, right? It doesn't exist. And if you read the books that were published by the Google Press back in the days when Nicolas Canelos was publishing a lot about theater history, it stops, sorry folks, but it usually stops in San Antonio and maybe Austin. It doesn't go any further north.
Yeah.
So basically, there's just a partial, very fragmented history of Hispanic, Latino, Chicano theater in Tejas. And so we're working to build that. So if you can help us with that, that would be really great. Does anybody have a call for submissions? We'd love to hear from you. Spread the word far and wide. That's it for me. Yeah, thank you.
Probably one of the things that I didn't do at the beginning, I'm really bad about it, introduction. People are going, who is that guy? So, and I'm usually a little bit of a performer, so I usually do a little something. But anyway, so I just jumped in. Like, so I'm Lorenzo Garcia. I'm department chair at the University of North Texas, right up the street, right in Denton, Texas. And this is my colleague, Espanol.
And I'm actually in the Department of World Languages and Literatures. I actually teach all the stuff in Spanish. So I teach Latin American and Latino theater in Spanish, but I write in English. And for those of you, this is thanks to Cora banging on the door of places like Theater Jones for a long time. Theater Jones is an online performance review venue, theater with a T-E-R, Theater Jones, and they just hired me, I'm for nothing, for free, I'm the first Latina or Latino to review works by Latinos and Latinas. So they also are interested in interviews, question and answer, articles, so if you ever have any work that you're interested in coming up, maybe we end up doing some kind of collaborative thing. You know, there's a venue to promote that online, so that's really kind of a cool thing. And maybe we can start off by just who are here today, TANTO members. Stay up.
I'm the only member.
So can you introduce yourself real quickly, please?
Kenny Wolves.
David Lozano, Academy of Theater Company.
Rod Gutson, the Dolores, also Academy of Ensemble.
Vanessa Nicole Taylor, director and company member of Academy of
Theatre Dallas, artistic director of Teatro Dallas.
Foro Carbona.
My name is Foro Carbona. My name is Carabina.
Mariana Maria from Cabalache Teatro Español, I'm an actress here. How do you think?
Frida.
So maybe we can go around the room really quickly, and maybe you can identify who you are, and then if you're an individual artist or a company that you're representing. And we'll start here.
Okay. Can I stand up?
Yes, please. Yes, please.
Can I come over there?
Buenas tardes, everybody. Sí, Carlos Flores, producer, Teatro Chicano, and also the Teatro Chicano Workshop out of Texas. We've been around 5 years. We produced with Lorraine Cloutier and Lorraine Community College.
I'm Richard Reyes, Artistic Director of Teatro Vivo, Austin, Texas, and one of the founders of the company with
Joanna.
And you are the
executive director.
So I handle everything that's behind the curtain, and she handles everything in front of the curtain.
I'm Molly Ortiz. I am an actor, playwright, spoken word poet. I am working on my master's at UT Pan Am in the Lower Rio Grande Valley.
I'm from San Antonio. I'm a playwright, an actor, a musician, recording artist, and just founded Teatro Farolito, multicultural theater company, to fill that void in San Antonio because we don't have a professional theater company.
Hello, my name is Kinan Valdez. I'm
the
director of Teatro Farolito, and I'm also a freelance actor, performer, solo show performer, writer.
Hello, I'm Marisana Balada, and independent theater artist, director, playwright, producer, cultural worker, and
I'm Joel Celestino Settles, the Theater Arts Program Director at SAC, Alasi Theater Company, and Southdale member as well. And act and jump in shows and help folks do their shows in San Antonio.
I'm Roxanne Sugar Asse, and I'm a professor at UT Austin, but I'm also, still in my water. I'm a playwright, a scholar, and a proud member of Teatro Vivo on occasion, and that's it.
My name is Marcy McMahon, and I am a professor at the University of Texas Pan American in the Rio Grande Valley, and I teach primarily Latino literature, but I specialize in theater and trying to get more theater performance, Latino theater performance out of in our community and at the university that I teach at. So I'm glad to be here.
My name is Beck Hardis. I'm a student and I'm an intern at Gabby Theater.
I'm Rafael De Maia. I'm at the Oak Cliff Cultural Center, but I am an actor, a hip hop artist, entrepreneur, anything. I work with Gabby Theater Company. I work with Death of Dallas. And,
Hello. Okay, so what we felt that the purpose of this meeting would be to enhance the visibility
Latinos and to create networks of communication. So one of the projects Tammy Gomez has undertaken, she'd like to talk to you all about it, and then we'd like to ask Rupert to share some ideas that we talked about a couple weeks ago when I was down in Austin. Seems like a great opportunity. So let me start with Tammy.
So when it was proposed and indeed promised that we're going to create this volume, and we have already discussed whether it's going to be volume one of the series, and that sounds really exciting to go ahead and say yes, it's going to be volume one of the series of Latino Chicano produced works from Texas-based artists. I thought, well, in order to get the word out to the people who need to see this call for submissions, we need to come up with a mailing list, the emailing list. And then I thought, well, where is that document? It's nowhere. It's not on the internet. It doesn't exist yet. And I thought, well, I'm trying to live as an elder by that idea that we are the ones we've been waiting for. So I'm the one that's doing that, creating that list, that searchable database that will be shared publicly and vociferally with anybody who wants to see it. And so in volunteering to just step up and create this spreadsheet, it starts with a spreadsheet with just your names, and if you're a Texas-based playwright, Roxanne, you're on the list, Amalia. There were people who came to mind immediately, Rodney, because I know your work. I've traveled all around, and I mentioned earlier today that we're the reason why Texas, the Chicano Latino Theater Alliance seem to be already moving very quickly and getting on the road, on the path, according to our mission and agendas, is because we already know each other. We're migrant art workers. A lot of us have traveled to and fro, like Maricela, now based in San Antonio, previously resided and worked here. And I lived in Austin for 10 years, which is where I met Rodney. Rodney's now in Denton. So we're migrant art workers. And so we already know each other. We're already networked in. But in terms of this document that's, you know, playwrights, Texas-based, previously produced works, I haven't seen the document yet. I'm happy to be creating it because it gives me a reason to get in touch with all of you again and reify and update my knowledge, my information about you, what you're working on now. And every time, because we are sharing, caring group of people in our community, we do that. We act like familia as soon as we meet each other. Is anytime I reach out to Rupert, and he was in the middle of your festival, your new play festival, and right away he said, here's names of some playwrights. And then mere days after the end of the festival, he had the emails to me, email addresses of these people. That's how we work, that's how we care. And thank you, Rupert, for that. And so the list is growing. I have over 65 names, and there's more coming through the pipe. So I'm very, very happy about that. And the added bonus of this is this document is going to be included in the volume that we're producing. So it will be a nice appendix to what Teresa and Vanessa and Lorenzo are going to put together. I'm very excited. So please get in touch with me. If you have anybody to suggest, I will do the digging and contacting. I'll reach out to these folks. If you could just give me the contact information, be it a phone number, email address is preferable. I'd rather not do everything through Facebook. I spend way too much time on that, but a private email is preferable. And the sooner the better, of course, because I want to be sure that we get out and get the call for submissions out to as many folks as soon as possible. And tamigomexican@yahoo.com is one of my email addresses that's permanent.
So it's on the call. And tell me, who all are you studying? You just playwrights, actors, designers, directors, who all is the base?
This is already turning into a part-time job that I'm not getting paid for just to do the playwright, because I want to do it right. I'm too old and too, I don't want to do things, cocked or whatever. Also, I want to be sure to be as thorough as possible with this, and I'm a playwright as well, so I want to know who my homies are. So that's where I am. And as far as the information, another aspect of what I feel part of my agenda or my mission is, as a member of TANTO and any Latino-oriented theater group in the U.S., is that we are all living, breathing archivists of our work. And so we may not have yet the publication that y'all are going to create. We may not have yet this database that I'm working to create, but we all have information. We're all living, breathing archivists. So I challenge you to keep those up, wherever your notes are, in the shoebox or in a data file or in a jump drive, and
because we're getting so activated, we're probably gonna need that material in some form or fashion, be it with a blog or a searchable databases on a website that we create. Who knows, the sky's the limit, as they say. B.B. Olguin, Ben Olguin is a scholar who's writing about the work of Greg Barrios. And Deborah Paredes at UT Austin is also someone that I would mention.
Thank you.
Okay.
So Rem's invited to come and talk about ways of networking and sharing talent and ideas within the different alliances. And pretty much started with a conversation with this and about who would love to tour and we would love to bring other groups in that are touring. And one of the things that we run into is not knowing who's out there and also not knowing who to contact if we want to go somewhere. We do get asked a lot to go tour, and it's sort of like our shows are not designed that way. We design shows to run for 3 weeks in the theater, and they're too big to move. And if we knew we were going to be moving, we could design for another space, and we could also then take that theater, that same show, and move it off to another city. Now that's the big fantasy. I mean, so obviously we're not going to start touring tomorrow. You know, collaborations and working together are like marriages, and you don't start a relationship by starting a production. You know, you have to get to know each other and figure out what are the best ways that your company can help my company and your company can help us. But one of the things that we talked about a lot, and maybe I should call it the Rodney Garza Initiative, because he's already doing it to some extent, and that is, we find that a lot of our plays and a lot of our directors have really not gone off and learned. They've basically been doing the same thing for us for 12 years. And so it's sort of like, how do we get new talent, new blood? And so we talked about maybe just bringing in a director. And I know you've directed in Houston, San Antonio, and Fort Worth, and Dallas, and I don't know where else, probably. But just again, I've seen his work in almost every one of those cities. So the idea is, how do we network so that we can bring that new blood into, like, to Austin, say. And there's a wonderful thing in Austin called Fusebox Festival. I don't know if you've heard of that festival or not. If you get a chance to participate or see some of that, it's really wonderful because they bring talent in from all over the world. And they're going to be bringing groups from South America. Dance group is coming in, I think, for the next one. They're trying to get all visas and stuff. But you'd be amazed at the information or the things that people are doing in theater, like in Europe and stuff, that we don't see here. And I'm just wondering what's going on in Dallas, what's going on in San Antonio, what's going on in Houston, up in North Texas, you know, and then. And maybe by exchanging, like, just the directors, we do something similar to bringing a show. And the idea would be that they bring a play that they've already directed. The idea that they've already directed, they've already worked, and then so they're basically bringing the production to Austin, or Austin going to San Antonio, or vice versa. So that you're not reinventing that whole production. It's already been done in one place and you bring it. So that it actually kind of cuts down the time and design. And again, these are just all fantasies right now. These are all ideas that are just going out and stuff. Be great to have. I love that we're getting a list of playwrights, because we get asked too a lot. And we do a playwright festival, we get submissions of scripts, and so we get quite a lot of playwrights. They go through a process of being read and produced. We actually produced almost every one of the plays that we've done in our writing festival, including Mariachi Girl, which we just finished up a very successful run of that, which is coming to Dallas, right? So one of the things that we would like to do, though, is to get to know each other better so that we can start this exchange of ideas. I know that I've known Quota for a long time, but really, I've never seen one of your plays. I've never been to Dallas to see a play. You know, I mean, it's
we worked together.
Yes, we actually did a commercial together.
Doing commercials.
Years and years ago. Yeah. And I know you've come to Austin years and years ago. You had come to Austin and done some
work.
So so some of these things have happened, but then been lost and forgotten. We did a little bit of a collaboration, kind of with Say C. We were at their space, but basically the same production we had in Austin. We took a 2 year space, same set, same costumes. Obviously not the same lighting design, but we brought basically the same play with all the same cast and worked up, but under the auspices of Adagro Productions, which is in San Antonio too, right? I guess they're producing. I've seen little blurs. I guess. So what I would like to propose, and then we have a breakout room, is maybe that the first step might be to see each other's shows. And at that moment, if we have to travel to Dallas and maybe caravan together, come see a play, a Quota's play or Academia production, and then stay another day to actually kind of talk, have coffee, talk about what, you know, maybe talk about the production, talk about what things could be in the future. Just very informal conversation. San Antonio is so close to Austin, you know, stone throw. It's an hour by car now that we can run 80 miles an hour until we get insurance. So these are kind of things that we would like that Austin and Teatro Vivo was interested in doing. It's getting this informal context started with the vision of talent exchanges, of new plays, and you know, maybe even a touring circuit. That's my fantasy, to see a Latino touring circuit in Austin that goes from Dallas through Austin to San Marcos, maybe even now, and it has some programs that are happening in San Marcos. San Antonio, Laredo, and then, you know, again, El Paso is pretty far away. But when you hit San Antonio, right, in Laredo, then the valley, the whole valley's opened up, McAllen, Arlington, Brownsville, then up through Kingsville and Corpus and Houston. So there is a circuit that exists that we won't have to travel real far to hit. But that's a real, like I said, a big fantasy of mine, always to be able to take off and do that kind of thing. And knowing that there's a group there that's already waiting for you and helping promote. Because that's what we don't, you know, you tour, you have to, you don't have somebody to help you do all the promotion and everything. It doesn't do you good. We have gone to McAllen and had two different experiences. One, we had a very good promotion and did a show that we did. Another one, we had a terrible promotion, had 10 people in the audience, you know, for two shows. So that's kind of thing you don't like happening. So the little conversations, I think, are really important. I don't think we have a breakout group and do some other things.
Yeah, and I was
going to
ask
this.
Is there
going
to be a website so that perhaps coming companies
That's our idea.
So if I want to see what's happening in the camera.
We have a Facebook group.
We have a Facebook group, TANTO. You're all welcome to join. TANTO. But we have talked about the idea of creating a central website with links to works by other theaters. So yeah, that's definitely on our to-do list. Absolutely.
To help jumpstart these types of collaborations or possible tourings. And in San Antonio, we have an event called Illuminati, which is it's always the second Saturday in March. It's an open call that we have. I've served on the Theater and Performance Committee for two years, and this will be my third, but I would love to see a massive explosion of theatrical proposals. There was one proposal that was a solo artist from Spain. He was, let's take him, he's from out of town. It's a locally produced performance, but we have over 300,000 people attend. And there's funding there already in place that's supported, you know, through an infrastructure that's supported through the mayor's office. So the open call, no matter where you live. So this artist from Spain proposed to come. Think about him, he proposed, and it was like he asked for $1,500. We're like, he's in. And then he had to, so at that point, then he had to revise his proposal, said, I forgot I have to bring my tech person. And then it's like, you said $1,500, and that's what we need to keep. If you can't come with $1,500, I mean, that's like, isn't that like, it would be wonderful to travel with? Like, yeah. Somewhere in Texas? Yeah. You know, you can just come on down, have your performance. So the open call for that is going to typically happen in December. So, you know, not only I think our local theater teatristas need to apply.
What if I do?
Right now it's not, you can go to Lupinaria and say that, I think it's .org, or
mighty.com.
And I'll double check that before I leave to get you that. But the open call happens in November, December? No, probably November. And then you apply online, it's really easy. You ask for the money that you need, and then you don't ask for more later. That's another thing, I think, Latino artists, we undercut ourselves. This type of thing is like a good way to, like, if you have a project that can travel, that sort of might work in the open space, or we have theaters as well, but just like one night, we have resources, and you're guaranteed an audience. Like, we're guaranteed, 300,000 people. So let's use that resource to freak out San Antonio, Main Street Theater, say, oh my God, we got 40 theatrical applicants. That would freak them out. And I would be like, that's,
How about that?
Wow. But once this list is created, I will, you know, as soon as the information is out, I will forward that information. And that is one way instantaneously, like, you know, we have funding for that. You can be considered through a jury curated thing. And but, you know, at least that's one means to get you to San Antonio.
Okay. Lisa, and the is there like a time limit on those? Because I know in the past it's been like 20 minutes per performance. Is that still?
We've had like one act. It depends. But you need to think of like this particular event is primarily outdoors, although there's indoor theaters as well. But more like public space. If you have something site specific outside that might work, or if you want to come in, maybe it's excerpt. The thing about it needs to be work. So it can't be anything that's, you know, we want, like, that's one thing. We want new work, experimental work, you know, work that's going to, like, excite, you know, San Antonio.
Yeah, I don't think there's time limits anymore, Robin, but I think, like, since it's curated, that probably goes into their decision, right? Because right? Like, they probably can't have 10 one acts.
Can we do this? Can we have maybe that piece of paper over there, the, like, the website for Kinan, or the website for whatever, you know, resources of websites that we already tap into, so that we don't have to worry about jotting it down again, right? So maybe that place would be the place to post. And if you want to break out into smaller groups, we've got, like, geographic area, but it seems like we're kind of working, how would you like to break out into groups? Like to break out into smaller groups by interest, by what you do, of playwrights versus actors versus companies, or by geographic area,
based on any company.
Interest, I think it means interest. What are we most interested in? I think touring and collaboration is great.
Where's that?
everybody. I'm Kinan Valdez, producing artistic director of the Teatro Campesino. But I came here back in December as part of a larger initiative of Latino theater makers from the last year who have been trying to just get together, right, build connections. And so it's really wonderful to see all the work that has happened here in North Texas. And it's great to see that there's now a linkage between San Antonio, Austin, and Dallas, Texas. And so there are other people from the conference who are still making their way over, so I apologize for some of our tardiness. I understand that you've had a meeting. One of the things that I wanted to talk a little bit today about with you is the idea of the Latino Theater Commons. And so those of you who are a part of the conference tomorrow during the Latinos in Theater, the new movement, we'll be going more specifically and in-depth about what is happening. But the general gist of the idea is that there are four major initiatives. One is the creation of a new space that's through HowlRound, and I'm sure you mentioned it already earlier, what is Café Onda. And the person you want to talk to about activating Café Onda for your local and regional efforts is by the Tlaloc Rivas, who will be present tonight, I believe, but is also at the conference, Tlaloc Rivas. He is the co-chair of the Latino Theater Commons with Ann Romero Garcia. So those are the two people who are initiating the Latino Theater Commons. There is also a large steering committee of, I believe it's about 25 theater makers, that we're all approaching theater from different ways. Some of us are still working at the community level. Some of us are actually pioneering new programs in the American regional theater. And so what the Latino Theater Commons is doing is taking a look at the breadth and depth of the entire field. And so the initiatives that we're focusing on are this website, Café Onda, that there's going to be next year a festival to regenerate the idea of having national festivals across the country together. That will be in Los Angeles. Another festival that will happen in DePaul University. And the most recent thing that's happening, actually quite soon, is the idea of hosting a national convening this year in Boston. So it'll be the first one of its kind in 25 years since the last days of Dennis. One of the things about it, though, and this is where we need to speak about it, is because it's 100 participants. It's really 100 participants who represent all the type of work that's happening on the national level. So all of us participating in that convening are going to be delegates or representatives of other kinds of places and work. So just throw that out. We'll be discussing it more extensively. But one of the opportunities that this presents for us with this convening is to begin pioneering the idea of having satellite regions that will be able to connect directly into the convening itself. And so one of the ideas that we had, and that we wanted to talk to you about here in North Texas, is the idea of having a satellite convening here in Dallas at the same time that the convening is happening in Boston, so those people that can't make it out there will have an opportunity to interface with those people in Boston and speak about what's happening here. So we have this cross-regional conversation happening in real time. Part of the idea is with this new technology, perhaps we can use it as a way for us to communicate over time. So I heard you mention right now about how are we going to be able to create space to communicate between San Antonio, Austin, and North Texas. Well, this convening and the technology and the live streaming through HowlRound TV will give us the opportunity to test that, is to say we are going to just explore this as a new way of communicating to see if it functions, right? One-on-one, groups on groups, and eventually may lead to other different types of communication. But that's what I'm going to talk about with you today, is the idea of using this particular group, your organizing efforts, to pioneer this satellite site for the convening in Boston in October and November. So how do you all feel about it?
Yeah.
So I think there's implications for everybody across the world. And I think we're all really impressed with all the work that you've done in Texas and the fact that you've already suddenly reached out and connected to different cities and different regions. It's really quite exciting.
That's right.
Yeah, it is exciting. So that is one of the updates that I have for you. It's just so we can talk about it. And I guess the question is, as the convening begins to take shape, as we start figuring out the operating mechanism to make this work, I guess we will be talking directly to the principal organizers TANTO in order to pioneer that. And I realize that San Antonio is a little bit separate. What's the time difference? How long does it take to get here from San Antonio?
6, 5, 6 hours.
It's huge, right? Okay. And so it's one of those things where we'll have to test to see how many places we can create. But there's numerous opportunities right now as the convening is being shaped in this participatory process. So, yes?
I have a good idea about the struggles that first the Spanish speakers have for understanding the whole conversation that we have. And as a first Spanish speaker, I have some struggles sometimes understanding what is going on. Then how can we open a window just for giving some of the most important and basic information for those who doesn't understand the whole conversation? Because I think it's very important, the voice of all of us. Then that's something that maybe, I don't know if we have ideas right now, but maybe we can have some creator that can help us to incorporate that voice to the conversation.
Right, and that's a great comment, and also something to think about as we shape the convening institutions. Any other comments or questions about it?
Yeah, in addition to the possibility of sort of exchanging information, you know, in real time, conferences, I think earlier folks were talking about they were sort of broadcasting plays and things like that. I mean, is there a broadcast element to this, especially like we were talking about earlier, HowlRound TV and its connection to the Latino Theater Commons? I mean, is there eventually sort of an idea for broadcasting content?
That's essentially what HowlRound TV does. It's
okay.
A multi-use platform. And I should say that the Latino Theater Commons is hosted by HowlRound. Is the entity that's cultivating the idea of the commons, and so consequently, the Latino Theater Commons is not a project, but it's being nurtured and cultivated. Yeah.
Could you talk about the title? Because for me, it seems a little foreign, the commons and maybe the conceptual background behind that.
And that's a great question. We had a conversation, I think, in Boston about it, right? The idea of what is a commons. And Vijay actually could speak a little bit about it.
So the a basic definition of the commons is wealth and or resources. And wealth doesn't mean money, but wealth in terms of things that elevate, that benefit people. And so commons is wealth or resources that belong to or can benefit a community. And inherent in that idea is a community self-identified, self-organized, that decide that they're going to start to work together to steward and tend to and develop and produce a commons for everyone's benefit. So it has a lot of meaning, I guess, for the Latino theater movement in terms of joining together in very new ways to produce a wealth for everyone in their local communities and also on a global or national scale.
And what are some of the, I guess, the key objectives, you know, sort of short term and long term? I mean, is it sort of like a library, like sort of like this sort of, you know what I mean? Is it a collection of knowledge that we all have, like, can access? Is it a way to, you know, what are some of the, I know those are gonna be figured out as we move forward, but what are some of the key objectives?
Well, that's part of what the convening is about, right? So that everybody can participate in defining and giving shape to what the priorities are. I think nobody wants to speak on behalf of anybody else, right? We've had that too often, where so many people say, this is what, from the top to the bottom, saying, I know what everyone else needs. No, we all have to have that conversation together because we are all doing different types of work, different approaches, and we all have learned from each other. How to make that happen, right? And nobody wants to make a certain assumption about someone else's work, about how they operate in a given community, how they operate relative to the field, right? So tomorrow we'll go into more specifics about that at the conference, but that is the idea. Another way, really quickly, about the commons is that there's
certain things that as human beings we all share in common that don't belong to anybody. Like the air we're all breathing right now. When we get to the point where somebody actually puts an economic principle on it, when they try to turn it into a commodity, that is the time we have to say no, right? That there are certain things that we all fundamentally share as human beings, and that should stay not somebody's private property, but everyone's, so that everyone has access to it. For us, one of the things that I like to think about in terms of the commons is the notion of a mipa, right? A community mipa that belongs to everybody. The garden that has it has beans growing next to corn. It's diverse, vibrant, but it doesn't necessarily belong to one person, but is a community resource that everybody has access to. The soil is rich, the soil feeds multiple communities, but it doesn't belong or it's not owned by anyone. So that helps in terms of us to conceptualize the notion of the commons, to say it's similar to a community mipa. That is the idea. And it's in the early stages in terms of the Latino Theater Commons, right? Part of what you're talking about will be design, it'll happen in the conversations that take place through Café Onda, that is the website. This first convening is just to start the conversation so that we can forge a sense of we again, right?
HowlRound, what is that organization? And how did this connect with the National Latino Theater Movement? And are there other sort of ethnic-based organizing groups that are sort of following this trajectory as well?
Well, yeah, HowlRound is it's a very new organization, just a couple of years old. And very briefly to say what we do is enable various kinds of artists, theater artists, and communities to self-organize and produce knowledge in order to share it widely and broadly, mostly through our online websites and platforms. And you can think of it as an open source project where we put out a platform on which it's an invitation for innovation and collaboration and pushing dialogue and conversation forward. So it's really a place for creating new conversation, putting new groups of people together in conversation, and just to allow that, to be enablers of that. Our role is not to be curators at all. It's actually anti-curation, but an opening up and developing of a platform for everyone to jump in, to self-identify, to produce themselves onto these platforms, and then we also applied for a Duke from the Doris Duke Foundation to support partially this convening in a couple of other initiatives that for the Latino Theater Commons, so that's the kind of the relationship between.
And are there other groups that you're helping to convene?
No, this is going to be the first one that's specifically that we're not actually organizing the convening. That's a whole different committee of which Kinan is part of. And so this is the first time that we're just kind of providing again, the platform, but this time it's the real material physical hosting space.
Yeah, tomorrow we'll go into the conversation a little bit more in depth about the origins of the Latino Theater Commons, but for those of you who won't be there, essentially what happened is that there's a playwright by the name of Karen Zacarias, who has, early in her residency,
I have a follow-up question to some of the questions back here, in your comment about anti-curation. So I have a little bit of a, not a concern, but just a question about archiving. In other words, what happens to all this information? Who's archiving it? Who's holding on to that archive? Who has open access to that archive?
Oh, yeah.
So not particularly interested in archival work, right? So it's a way to keep the story there rather than it appears one day and 2 days later it's gone. I will not have been there.
Oh yeah, so that's actually the part of the second part of our role in terms of enabling is that we steward the archival, the archive, and it's completely open access. Our operating principles are open source, open access, accessibility for all, and so it's going to be kept and made accessible to the field and to anyone who wants it.
And right now, this he's live streaming, right? So I just received a text from one of our theater company members in San Juan saying, "I'm looking at you right now." So right now, people are paying attention to this conversation, right? That's how open and transparent this technology allows the conversations to be. So, and in terms of back to Karen, Karen, when she went, was offered this residency, first thing she did, or at least one of the first things, said, "I want to be able to use this position to be able to have this conversation with a group of Latino theater makers." And she's was in residence, is in residence at the Arena stage in Washington, D.C., right? I believe Karen was born in Mexico City, right? Great, here's a young woman, right? And so this commitment was central to her work, right? But she talked to the people at Arena stage and said, "I want to host this conversation." And so they pulled together a group, I believe, of 8 people. This was early last year. And between last year and now, there's a lot of the movers and shakers at the Arena stage who are responsible for having these conversations, right? Either with Latinos in some cases, with taking a look at devised work and helping to tell the ensemble theater story itself. They eventually formed HowlRound. So they carried this sort of sense of ethos and energy about developing human resources with them. And so the Latino Theater Commons was born out of that particular conversation. And then at some point last year, they said, "Well, this was a great conversation with 8 people, but it's not enough to be able to get a true sense of what's happening. So we're going to cast a wider net." And that net brought in 25 more people who are part of this convening. And then everybody said, "Well, okay, 25 is great. It's wonderful anytime that we come together and share energy, but 25 is not enough. So we are casting the net to 100. Coming out of Boston, we will say, "This was fantastic, wonderful, beautiful, but 100 people is not enough. Let's cast it even wider." And so it's these circles that keep moving out. That is the Latino Theater Commons. Part of all of this gathering that we're doing now is a totally different conception about how to organize, right? It's the fact that we come together regionally, for those of us who are working in a particular area, to mobilize those resources, but to make connections with other groups just like them. That's why it's fantastic to see TANTO and Salta right here in the same space together. Blanca, right there, is from the Latino Theater Alliance of Los Angeles. These are all our organizations, right? These are the people who are the movers and the shakers in the trenches and the grounds now. These are the people that we can think horizontally about making those connections, right? The Latino Theater Commons is a hub, but these are the trenches. This is where all the work has to happen. This is where we need to keep moving and shaking in any way, in any form that we can make.
I have a question about the events that are scheduled for 2014 and their festivals. Are they both festivals? Because some of us have to prioritize, because 3 things are going to be convened starting late this year in Boston. What are the other 2? Have y'all set up time, locations, places for those?
Yeah, so the theater festivals, this was part of the initial conversation that was had in Washington, D.C. And they said, we need to have the festivals. We used to have this tradition, this legacy of festivals. I know there are still international festivals. There's a festival here in Dallas, right? There's another one in Miami. But most people are now unaware of the type of work that everyone else is doing. So they said, okay, we're going to try to organize at least a national festival, even though we all have international connections. But first, we also need to just, within these geographic boundaries, come together. The ideas of the 2 festivals, in my mind, and this will be fleshed out even more by the people who are initiating those, is 2 types of festivals. One is a festival for companies that are doing work. The other is play-driven. So those plays, individual playwrights that have written shows that are getting created. So the idea of the individual artist as an instigator of work, and the idea of a group of people who develop work or work collectively, collaboratively. Those are two different types of festivals. And the idea is that these festivals will be attached, will attach not necessarily like Tejas, but similar conversations about how do we push the aesthetic work forward. So it's a question of resources, but how also do we continue elevating the work that we're doing? How do we grow and become completely vibrant and powerful in our work?
So what I would like to see in that particular contract is we had talked about, even this one of the questions there, how we might also integrate within that particular festival a scholarly or research component, right? So you want to bring in, quote unquote, the historians and those who are writing about Latino theater there as well to engage in that particular discussion.
Absolutely.
Any ideas to time?
The festival, so I'm the only one here that's representing this right now. The festival is fall of 2014, is the first one in Los Angeles. And that is actually, when we talk about all the resources that we have, the person who is the main primary mover and shaker for this is José Luis Valenzuela of the Los Angeles Theater Company. The Los Angeles Theater Company operates the Los Angeles Theater Center, which has four different theatrical spaces. And then they recently started utilizing their gallery space as a fifth performance space. So we're looking at the resources that already exist, right? You said we have this facility that has a potential of five performance spaces in a major metropolitan area where there's a major Latino population, right? So there's per capita a lot of artists and workers. So it's a vibrant place to have a particular festival, right? But that's part of the trick too, is being able to activate the access to those resources. And so we all need to be a part of that process. Even these conversations, they do that, right? They turn this particular space into our space where we can have conversations about making art, about organizing at the same time that we're celebrating the creative genius that might be on the walls or on the stages, right? So it becomes total experience, holistic experience approach to making life and art.
Kinan, could you discuss more or less geographically what areas are already vibrant in terms of alliances and looking into the national network? I mean, we were here, I know you've spoken about, we know about LA and I think Miami, and what other areas are working already, you know, creating alliances?
Yes. Okay, so there is, obviously you heard about Los Angeles, right? So Los Angeles is very much similar to this particular entity in the sense that it is an alliance or a network that features people who are individual artists, right? And Blanca can actually, would you like to speak a little bit about it? That's okay. She can tell you more about the Los Angeles. I'm not from Los Angeles, right? I go to the meetings because I'm California-based. But she's actually one of the movers and shakers of the Los Angeles Theater Alliance.
So what we're actually doing is we decided we're going to have an encuentro, which is happening next month. And what it basically is to us is the state of the union of what Latino theater is in LA. We haven't really seen the whole scope of it because we're so busy with our own theater companies that we completely forget that there's other people out there. And we don't get to talk about each other's work or get to judge each other's work or even tell each other the honest truth about our work. And that's the only way we're going to elevate this. So we got together, we got a cohort of the major disciplines, acting, producing, directing, writing, and administration also. And they're just gonna present the State of the Union of what LA is going through. In turn, what we're doing as an alliance and as an alliance member, we want to establish some kind of organization where we could work with other people who are organizing like this. Like, one of our theaters could come to Dallas. And we could find out a way for our alliance's goal is for you guys not to pay for it, but for us to do it. For us to say we have a paid show, pay the actors, all we need is for the actors to stay somewhere, and a space. Are you willing to do that? Like, we're really thinking about partnering up and showing each other's work and seeing, because I know your issues are completely different from LA issues. And I know there's a commonality in them, but there's still different issues that have to happen. And your issues might be something we already solved. And our issue might be so small in your world that you guys could solve it for us. So that's our goal in that way. And hopefully the commons, you know, will organize everybody in this nation and do something about our disorganization.
So that's a snapshot of Los Angeles, right? So it's a group of theater makers, it's also companies that have to do spaces and trying to develop the resource and the communication. There's ALFA, the Alliance for Theater Art, Latino Theater Artists in Chicago. That is essentially more of a networking organization. That is the individual artists who are trying to connect, figure out, to develop skills. Like in some cases, it's generated by actors who say, hey, we're going to have this particular workshop on how to audition for a particular work. Or you might want to take a look at this particular person who has this specialty. So they're organized more like salons in the sense that they have these conversations, they have these skill building sessions, and always an opportunity to network with each other to create these opportunities. New York Latino Theater Alliance is a consortium of 9 theater companies. These are all companies that have their own particular space. And for them, the criteria, section is one, right? Criteria of joining the alliance is having access to space. So they advocate on behalf of all these 9 companies. They used to see themselves somewhat in competition with each other, and at some point said, we are not each other's competitors. We are not fighting for the same audiences. We touch everybody, we need to expand. So they came together and said, how can we marshal the resources that we have at our disposal in the here and now? We have these spaces, we all have props, we all have costumes. How can we work and organize our creative process, our seasons, in order to be able to capitalize on all of these particular groups? The second part is that they advocate and tell the story and the power of Latino theater in New York, not just from an artist standpoint, but from an economic standpoint as well. How much impact that collectively the 9 companies are having on the economy, on creating jobs, on creating educational opportunities touching children. So it's focusing on telling the story of our impact, which is great. And when you focus on one small company, you say, okay, well, everybody's doing that. But when you pull everybody together and say, collectively, this is how much we are generating for each other. That is a different story. And they've done that strategically in order to be able to engage with the political structure of New York, right? Which is shaped by every state is different, right? Every city is different. And so they've generated for that. There are 2 interesting things that have come out of New York, the Alliance, most recently. One is that because one theater company is renovating their space, they are doing their entire season in one of the other company's spaces. And they've worked out the schedule in order to make that happen, right? So one theater said, come in, we let you in. And use and do your season. The second is by organizing together, 2 theater companies realized that they had much more in common than they had noticed before. They are in the process of organizing a merger. So 2 of these theater companies have the intention to merge into 1 theater company. That is Pregones, Teatro Pregones, and the Puerto Rican Traveling Theater. Sometime by next year, perhaps you will see this 2 theater companies become 1 because they were that aligned in terms of the work. Now imagine, like all of us have our own individual approaches. Sometimes we get attached to the things we create, and sometimes we want to say, well, maybe what I'm doing might be better served this way. And so that is the alliance in New York. There is also an online community. That is one of the things that jump-started some of this, besides the conversation that happened in DC. And that is actually TCG's online community, the year-round conference. It's called TCG 2.0. That actually was invented for people to be able to look at their schedules, to communicate with one another,
But once we saw that this was an access and a resource that we all could use, even if you're not a member of TCG, we said go and join 2.0 so that at any particular moment you can have another conversation with any Latino theater maker, any writer, director, administrator, producer, scholar, and send them a little note. So it is an access for all of you, and I encourage all of you, even if you're a member of TCG or not, to become a member of TCG 2.0. This is a resource that exists and will allow everybody to come in. And it's important for us to think of this as a space of organizing that's not geographic, but transcends geography, transcends physical space, but nonetheless extremely important as well.
There's another alliance in Northwest.
The Pacific Northwest?
Yeah, is there an alliance?
What is happening? Okay, so those are the groups that have actually formed. There are certain initiatives to form alliances or networks. In the Pacific Northwest, because of the Latino Theater and because of Ese Teatro of Seattle, there have been a series of conversations that have begun to take place between Oregon and Washington State. It's a much wider space. Oh, well, there, oh yeah, you can speak about it, but she's from the Minami, from Miracle Theater. About, they're wondering about the initiative, they're talking about the alliances.
The initiative is that, yeah, it's a, we don't have anything nearly as formal and well thought out as the initiatives that are being formed in LA here, certainly, and in New York and in Chicago as well. What we have is friendship. We have one company and another company 3 hours away in Seattle. We're in Portland. They're emerging. We have a longer history. And we're trying to figure out ways in which we can share artists. So, for example, we had a visiting director who we brought in, who then, as we flew out, but who then took time out of his directing schedule to travel up to Seattle and offer workshops there. We would have done it with a playwright too, had her time allowed. So that kind of thing, where, you know, we're helping to bring in artists that we then they cover the expense of bringing them up there and then doing a workshop there in directing, which is what they need, which is a professional development. In that case, directorial, she would come up in terms of playwriting. So we're trying to figure it out as we go. We're friends, and so that makes it kind of easy to sort of be in conversation about the work that they're doing and how can we be supportive. And then the vice versa is another question, but I certainly look to that area to see if there's a pool of actors in particular that might come down. But it's an informal, it's a friendship, and because there's only two of us, it's a little bit easier to define that. We feel like we're part of the conversation, and Rose, who's the artistic director, is going to be joining the Latino Theater Commons conversation in the fall. So it's, you know, bringing the voices to the table.
And then I think Olga is also one of, she's a member of the Latino Theater Commons, the artistic director of the Miracle Theater, but she's also pioneering the idea of having these, not necessarily a single serving, but anytime there's an opportunity that presents itself where we're in the room together, is to organize a conversation, just to check in, right? Just so we can look each other in the face and see each other. So she did that at the festivals in Miami, in Tucson.
International Hispanic Theater Festival in Miami, we had a lot of the atmosphere, artists there, and the artists who were in Miami. It was a completely different conversation. What's fascinating about that is really to take the pulse of what are the concerns there, which are vastly different from, I'm sure, what's happening here in Texas, and then do the same thing. The other opportunity I had was to have a conversation in Tucson, the Borderlands Theater, and the folks there. And their issues, which are very different from other regions, and then from there, try to be part of adding to the narrative, in essence, of what is Latino theater in its similarities and in its diversity.
So, and particularly in Miami, the issue of language, the Spanish language, was prominent, right, with the community in Miami.
Very big. They asked if the notes we send out in Spanish. I mean, so much of their work is Spanish language. It's very international. Their issue is training also. The big training program that Spanish, 2-year Spanish language conservatory, in essence. Fabulous. So, I mean, how many people from around the country to take advantage of that? Some can, some cannot.
starting from scratch again. We keep starting from scratch with developing artists, and unfortunately they will go away. So it's an interesting thing.
So that just gives you a brief snapshot. There's a much work to do, but every time we come together, it's an incredible gift for us to spend time with each other. There's actually people online right now. Have you engaged at all with this yet?
No.
There are people here, right now, that are having a conversation. Come and say hello.
I know for sure that there's several people from California who are viewing this right now.
You're in your real time. So tomorrow, those of you who are part of the conference will go into more detail. And the idea of using this particular space to pioneer that, you know, the dialogue for the convening will be wonderful. But I want to thank all of you for just keeping up the fight, right? It's great to see everybody here.
Thank you.
I know we all have the same focus, because it's a long day, so I don't know what I'm going to do. But that's my report for now.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. One last thing, I have to say this as well, in terms of resources, is that there's a lot of us who have received training through different entities and organizations that exist. And so one of those I want to talk about is the National Association of Latino Arts and Culture. Most of you from San Antonio will be familiar with it. But I encourage all of you to take and do the NALAC Leadership Institute.
NALAC.
Leadership Institute. It's every summer in San Antonio. And they also have a national convening that has supported the work. But if anybody is interested in engaging, how do I expand the resources that I have? How can I just pivot both as an individual and also on behalf of my community? Think about doing the NALAC Leadership Institute. I know it radically changed my life in terms of the way that I saw things and needed to connect. And my
just some input from people that are living in San Antonio and are applying for the Leadership Institute. There's been some artists that have applied and applied again, and I know you're on the board of directors. So just as a heads up, there's some concern because once, like an individual artist especially, will apply, and there's no feedback in terms of what the infrastructure internally they're looking for in terms of applications. Like, is there a formula? There's only two artists per San Antonio per year. I don't know if there's something internally that we can communicate.
I'll be in San Antonio in the summer. I'll spread that message. But obviously, San Antonio and NALAC have a wonderful relationship, right? Every year, for how many years now? 13 years. There's been an artist from San Antonio present. In some other regions, we don't have that kind of representation, right? So recognize that it is a special relationship, and treat it as such, right? For those of you who are from San Antonio, go and speak to Maria de Leon, who now sits on the NEA council, right? Go and speak to Adriana. You can speak to me, and I will carry your message. I promise that, right?
Yeah,
which
is awesome.
Yeah, but I was saying,
so, you have a fan of, you know, of the Institute.
Yeah.
And so I just want to make sure that the resource that is shared, you know, and that more of us get to participate, especially from San Antonio, because we could be cheerleaders for that type of program as well and share that knowledge.
Well, that's the question. How can we acknowledge that special relationship that San Antonio has with NARA and make it something vibrant and spectacular for everybody, as it already is, right? I'm sure there's a few artists, right? As would be the case in any situation. But we shouldn't let any type of obstacle stop us or sour us, right? Do not let the obstacle sour your spirits,
mm-hmm.
Right? Never, never. We have to keep moving through them, right? Over them, under them.
Mm-hmm.
But don't poison your own spirit. That goes for all of us, right?
Yes.
So we want to engage everybody and feed our spirits.
I
want to
just second that, and in terms of knowledge in particular, their hearts are so in the right place, and they're trying so hard. I was just on a panel for them, and they received so many applications. This wasn't for the leadership, this was the NFA. And they try so hard to make, you know, to put together, and I don't know where it ended up, but there's just a lot of need, and there's not a lot of people to manage it all. And I think finding the time to make the phone call and try to talk to Maria there
2.0 is a resource. Your Facebook page is a great resource, right? Any email strand is great. So that's wonderful. Thank you. Thank you all for allowing me to speak.
Thank you. I'd like to thank you all for coming and for sharing, especially people who've come from far away, who've driven or flown here, and for sharing your ideas. Thank you very much. And